Hello and welcome to the BauTek Labs. Our mission today is to strip the motors and whatever parts we can find out of these. A few thrift store scanners I picked up not too long ago for a couple bucks a piece. And goal is to build ourselves a CNC table, hopefully something multi-tool that can take maybe laser and a rotary tool. But for now I'm trying just to get the small stepper motors out so that I have something to play with and kind of learn how that works with the Arduinos. I already have spent some time stripping a few other scanners and printers. I've got a whole bucket of electromechanicals here, and we'll go over what some of these do. Most of them not going to be great for our purposes, but we'll see what we can find. So what is a CNC table then? It's pretty simple. You basically have a carrier. This carrier is usually mounted on rails, sliders, some sort of device that lets it move freely back and forth, and usually this is the y-axis. And then on that carrier you're going to have a head, and this will usually be carrying maybe your laser, your multi-tool, a marker, whatever the heck it is that you want for a tool. And then this is on its own rail, and then this moves in the x-axis back and forth this way here. That's a very basic two-axis table. What we want in the end here is we're going to go for an actual three-axis where this carrier is also mounted on a vertical structure, and then that can move up and down in the z-axis. To do this, we need the rails or sliders, whatever the carrier rides on, plus we need stepper motors or some other form of mechanical movement that's very precise so that the computer knows exactly where this head is at all times. Now, the whole purpose of this is to take a pattern. You can make like a PDF or G-code, whatever you happen to have, and the head with the tool attached will cut out, etch, draw, whatever it happens to be for you using those computer coordinates. So it's very precise and you can get the same results every time that you run a piece through the table. So as I mentioned earlier, I did scavenge quite a few parts out of some printers already. This is about four printers worth of motors and other bits like that. A lot of these parts are very similar to what we're going to be doing with the CNC table. For instance here, this is a print head out of an Epson inkjet printer. And it's a very simple mechanism. You have your motor on the bottom here, and this is just a regular DC motor, just runs back and forth, nothing too special. That drives this little belt here, which is attached to the print head mechanism. So as you move it back and forth, you can just see it spools the motor up here. It knows which position this printhead is sitting thanks to this little plastic strip right here. It's got a very, very fine pattern of lines drawn onto it, and I'll see if I can get maybe a picture of those through a microscope so you can kind of see what that looks like. But that runs through this little guy right here, which is just a normal quadrature decoder, which basically has an infrared LED on one side and then two sensors to the left and the right. And depending on which way those are tripped, it knows it's moving left or if it's moving right. That's all sent to the controller here, which then relays it to the printer so it knows precisely where this is. Now, this kind of system, I don't know how well that's going to work for a CNC table. CNC tables are going to be a little messy. Depending on what we're cutting, we're going to get a lot of dust, a lot of smoke. And these are real prone to fouling. You can see this one's actually got some soda or something on it right now, which will surely muck up its positioning and cause all sorts of fun issues, blank spots on the page, who knows what. And we don't really want that with the CNC machine. I don't want to have to be cleaning this out every time I cut something. So this might be good for some practice, you know, playing with these encoder strips. Other than that, we've got a few control boards, mainly to steal their encoders if we want. A few nice inductors, capacitors, if we get real desperate we might strip those off, and we do have some buttons we can play with. Did get some healthy DC motors out of there, so another one that was belt driven. So I'm sure we can use that for something further down the road. And then the other big thing we got was something that's very similar to the way that the printhead works. This is for the paper feed. So again, we have motor, just regular old DC motor, running this belt drive system. It's got a nice little tensioner on it to keep that belt in place. And again, it's going to be real hard to see, but on the very edge it has a very similar pattern to what we had on the printhead system. And then on this printer, this disc just ran through here, and another quadrature encoder that just picks up and runs everything there. Off of one of the Epsons, I did manage to get a few FETs, things like that, and a 48 volt or 42 volt power supply. So that'll be good for the motors. Another interesting bit I got off of one of the HP printers was this guy, and this is going to be absolutely no use to us, but it's kind of neat. Same type of thing. It's got just a real basic encoder on it. But what this is it's a micro pump. This is part of one of the HPs that used to draw all the ink cartridge through a pump into a couple of reservoirs. And then when you printed, and this actually ran to the print heads here, it would run the pump, pressurize the print heads, and that's where you got your ink. Really crappy system because it gets a pinhole leak in it every freaking time and eventually kills it like this one. But I thought I'd keep it because, who knows. So I thought it might be a good idea to actually plug these in and see if they function first before we start ripping them apart. That way, once we take them apart, we can also meter what voltages are going to the motors and the other components. It's something which I didn't do when I took those printers apart, and really regret it because it's a huge pain going through all the data sheets just to find the data for things I'm really just playing with for now. So I plugged this guy in, you know. I should have used just my tiny little 12 volt adapter here, 12 volts, amp and a half. But instead I decided, I'll just use the big guy I just salvaged from some amp thing. So I used this. And I failed to notice that it is actually 12 volts AC. Weird, right? Well, it didn't go over so well. Made some funny noises, and you can't really see it now, but underneath this glass, it's actually filled with magic smoke. So once we take that apart, we should get a nice puff of it flying out. So I don't know how much of this is fried. We'll see when I take it apart. It does not power up anymore, suffice to say. But the motor might still be fine. I don't know. It's still worth taking a look, so we'll dive into that soon. We'll start with the HP ScanJet 3500C here. So earlier I did have power and USB connected to it, but wasn't getting really anything out of it. It does detect on the computer, so somebody's home in there. Unfortunately, the only drivers are for Vista 32-bit, and I'm not screwing with that. So we'll just take it apart and hope for the best. Piece of cake. And we'll definitely be careful of the glass here. This is a good tempered, usually optical quality pane. So who knows, make a picture frame or something stupid like that out of it. Bummer, that just barely does not fit. We'll have to do it the old-fashioned way. Always worth a try. There goes that. I've just got a couple of nice little tactical buttons on there. Those I can donate for someone who wants to play with them. Check under these feet here. Nope, nothing there. Just the one screw in the back. Look like there's some like little catches down there. Oh yeah, okay. Well, that's nice and easy. There's our glass, and it is kind of that Battlestar Galactica paper format, huh? Just a 45 degree cut corners. Oh, not even 45 in the corner. That's a bummer. But it is tempered and finished, so pop that out at a later time and use it for something. Let's see what we got here. Ah, beautiful. So here, this looks like we do have a stepper motor driving this whole thing. We've got the four wires here. It's got a nice gear drive to the whole thing, so it can move very, very smoothly. So let's get that out of there. Now this rod, this might be usable for some of our test stuff. The overall dimensions of the CNC table initially are probably going to look about 24 by 12 inches. And we've got a good 16 inches on this guy, so that might be something we can recycle as well, because it's a nice polished rod, and we might be able to get the... Oh, it just sets on there. There's nothing even really that special. Okay. So we'll disconnect this guy. And that's pretty much just held down here by a couple of ferrites that are clipped in, so we'll just break the clips off. Tougher than we thought. And might as well keep these. They can come in handy. Not something that you run across every day. The flat flex, probably not so much. I usually end up tossing most of this because if you really want to use it, you have to desolder the connectors from the boards. You know, and it's just kind of a pain. Screws, don't really care about those. Those can go too. I've got more than enough screws laying around. Now, this ribbon cable I will keep. That does come in handy. It's really easy to solder. Kind of funny, it's got this little loop back here. Not sure what the purpose of that is, but there it is. And there's our driver board right there. Nothing too crazy. And I can definitely post a number of the chips if anybody is curious what any of these do. Don't know if there's much we'll be able to steal off of this. It does look like we do have a diode here. Just a little photodiode that must detect. So let's see, this goes like this. Ah, yeah, there's a little blade here that rests in there. So when this reaches its home position, it knows to stop, hopefully before it hits the back of the board and blows anything up, or at least I imagine things blowing up. So we'll keep that in the scrap bin, might be worth a little bit. And then here's the actual printhead itself. This is a CFL tube in here that actually lights up the material that you're scanning, so that, and then underneath here you've actually got the imaging element. So the CFL lights it up, and then the image element can see what's going on here. The CFL, we could actually maybe use that for something. This board does have the transformer on it, because it does operate at high AC voltage. So we'll take this out of here, and you never know, we might find a use for it. Otherwise, the board itself is pretty basic. A few drivers. And really nothing much more of interest. But who knows, maybe we'll have the CFLs, we can throw them in onto the table to light up the work as we go, so you can keep an eye on it. Oh, here we go. it looks like actually this whole drive assembly lifts out. Ah, yeah, as one piece. So we have our little tensioner with a spring here that keeps the belt properly tensioned with just a little roller at the end. And there's where it drives off of that gear, and there's our little stepper motor. Now the fun part. I think that's actually a pressed gear on there. So if we want to get that out to play with it, we're going to have to get the gear tool out to actually pull the gear off so that the motor can separate, which is fine. That's not a huge deal. I don't know. I might actually keep it all attached to this just for playing for now. So, all right. And our next victim, the Microtek ScanMaker 4800. What a beast, right? This one actually has old parallel and a USB interface on it, so I have no idea how old this one is, but it's up there. This one I picked out of the pile because I know for sure it has a stepper motor in it and a pretty decent sized one. It's probably, you can't really see it in there. Well, maybe you can, just back there. Ooh, yeah, you can really smell that too. Oops. Now these stepper motors, these are pretty small, so I probably won't end up using these for the final table. They're going to be pretty wimpy, and I really don't know how accurate they're going to be. I think for the table I want something that does maybe 1.8 degrees per step or something more along those lines. And definitely something with a bit of grunt behind it to move the carriage back and forth. It's going to be, you know, pretty decent as far as weight and friction goes. Now, I just see the two screws there. I didn't see anything on the bottom for this one. Let's check under these little feet. But at least the motors we get out of these will be good for testing our controller, because we are going to have to build a brushless controller for these stepper motors. And we can at least test how accurate that is. Hoping to use maybe an Arduino for the core of that or something along those lines. Nope, nothing under the feet. No little pull tabs that I see, or no other screws. Ah, but maybe on this front here. It can never hurt to pry when you really don't plan on ever putting this back together again. Ooh, fancy. It gets us to the buttons and all that stuff, but again, no screws still. Ah. This is probably where I should wear safety glasses, but okay, the glass is attached below. So this one I can probably just yank on this and not worry about shattering that pane. Or not. The glue is just coming off. Whoo! Yeah, that smells like magic smoke, all right. So it was a pretty decent plume of it that came off the backboard here. Once we get that out, we'll see what we can find for burn traces and see what we got. But as far as mechanicals go, very, very similar to the HP. Again, gear drive. And it looks like another one we'll have to... Well, no, that one might actually pull right out once we unscrew the motor. So that's cool. 4-ohm stepper, and it doesn't actually tell us. We do have a model number, so we can look up the specs on that. And we'll see how many steps per pulse that does. Nothing really for tactical buttons. These are just those stupid little, you know, like you'd get in a game controller or something along those lines. And there's our little sensor again to see if the carriage is at the limit or not. This one actually moves pretty janky. I don't know if that's because we just took the top off and it might rely on that a little bit. The HP had like the little gear channel that everything rode on here. So let's get this apart though and see what we got. Yay, our motor! That's kind of a neat little assembly, just how everything is very well contained there. Ah, shoot. And it doesn't look like this is actually screwed in. It's riveted or something along those lines. It's actually fused to this plate. So we can still get that out. It will require a little drilling just to drill out the flaring where that's attached. But no big deal. Still not bad for test parts, that's for sure. No other screws. Oh! Since this has the old interface here, we do have to... Got a bit of shielding with just a plastic card to keep it from shorting out. Okay, and we'll look at that in just a minute to see if we can find where that smoke came out. Let's check the rail. Very similar, just a little short of 16 on this one, but at least 12, so that would be good for some test parts. Diameter-wise, of course I should have gotten that out beforehand. If they're the same, that'd be great. 7.83 millimeters. 7.83 millimeters, exactly the same. Perfect. Well, that's lucky. And of course, we will find more scanners here as we do the thrift store shuffle. Or if I can get anybody to let go of their old stuff for recycling, I might make use of it there too. Ferrite. And then the way these actually attach the belt is really, I guess it works, but it's just a couple of teeth and then it just kind of slides out. So yeah, whatever works. It's kind of the way they all do it, so I assume it's pretty reliable. And again, we do have the transformer. So we're good there. Transformer, CFL, you never know. I don't know how awesome those really are, to tell the truth. But it can't hurt to play with it. Ah, now that's interesting. I kind of noticed that on the print head. It does have a couple of pretty decent magnets, actually really decent magnets, that were on top of the scan head there. Here's the other one. Let's actually get that out of there. Easy enough. And these I'll stick on the vent of magnets for future use. And I'm not going to really bother with this. I Ah, what the heck, it's just two screws. A couple of tiny LEDs and an optical discrete there. Boy, now that's a little foreboding. Oh, and then nice ferrite too. We got a couple of labels here for the buttons. This one is labeled virus button. Well, maybe a good thing I didn't plug this into my computer. And there's belt. And the end rolling device. And a piece of polished rod, nicely finished. And then the rest? Well, the rest is a mystery for my garbage man to figure out. They're gonna start thinking I'm a printer, scanner, serial killer here, and then I'm really in trouble. But let's take a look at this board and let's see if we can find maybe where this got fried. Okay, so I did find what damage I did to this poor Microtech scanner board. It was pretty easy to find actually once I got a good look at it. There's probably really not much I'd use off of this anyways. Maybe the header for the motor. Otherwise, the rest of it's really old junk, to be honest. I know for sure this cap is no longer any good. It's got a good bulge going to it. But the main thing I fried was this poor little ST Micro Devices chip right here. Happens to be an STL6219DS, and I'll post in the annotations what that happens to be once I look it up. It might be a little hard to see. Yeah, camera doesn't do too good at that, but there is a little glazed spot here, and if you look real close, a little pinhole where you can see where the magic smoke popped out. So, board is dead. Well, that's it for today. Thanks for watching. Hopefully you enjoyed that little scanner teardown. I'd like to make a big shout out to Dave Jones of the EEV blog. I've been watching your podcast for years, and it's really given me the inspiration to go through and chronicle some of the misadventures down here in the BauTek labs. We do have a few more projects coming up. I have the mech controller, needs a little bit of rebuild, and we can go over that sometime. Plus some of the Geek Squad unicorn stuff too. We're going to be rebuilding that to accept real-time control. So I'll get those videos up soon, and thanks again for watching. Have a good one, folks.